So now we go into a more, little bit more generic, generic part. So I will first tell you something about the company. Now that you're here, you cannot leave the room just now. You need to know something about the company. So a lot of people think 3D printing just came up the last 4 or 5 years. No, in contrast, it's already a topic that is 30 years old. So there is actually besides us also the 3D systems as a system vendor that started around that time when we started. So we actually, the company exists already more than 28 years. And you see here a picture of the building we are in right now. So what is our vision? A vision is that additive manufacturing, which is industrial 3D printing, is a key technology for advanced industrial production. So a technology that is not just used for prototyping or parts that you throw away where you want to have a quick printout, but real parts that you use in your daily life that are built into cars or into engines or whatever. And the mission, our mission on the way there is that we are a leading provider of solutions in this field, and we have systems and services, and I will provide more details on that, and they will be essential to the factories, the digital factories that are equipped with this technology in the future. So here's a little overview. The guy here at the top is Dr. Langer. He founded the company 28 years ago. And he's still the CEO of the EOS Group, so he's not the acting CEO of the EOS GmbH anymore. This has been taken over by Adrian Kepler, but he still owns all shares of the GmbH and of the group. And in the group, there is a number of other companies. Like there is a venture fund that invests in startups in 3D printing. There's a company that provides scan heads, like ScanLab in Puchheim is a company that also, where also Dr. Langer is the major shareholder, that provides the scan head units that are built into our machine. So it's all in the field of laser and scanning, what he does, but there is more companies than just EOS. So, but we are still family owned. We are headquartered here, but you'll see we have some global footprint, and our solution portfolio is machines that can print parts, but also the software that runs these machines and a little bit software ecosystem around it. You will see it. We develop materials, so powder, and we will have some examples there, both for plastic and metals. So we have plastic powder like nylon or others, and we have metal powders like from aluminium, titanium, diverse things that you can actually then use to produce the parts. But we also, of course, have a services offering, so to maintain the machine. But we also have consulting to help the customers get the technology into the production more quickly. And our goal is to provide end-to-end solutions so that the customer can get everything he needs to build parts from us from the beginning to the end. And yeah, by doing this, we help companies to establish a competitive advantage in their respective industry. And we have a wide field of application. Those machines, it can be used in the medical space, aerospace, tooling, consumer goods, automotive, lifestyle products. So there is a lot you can do with it because you can basically print anything. So then a little bit the history. You see we have a significant number of rate of growth in the last years. So we are the considering the industrial 3D printing, we have the largest footprint worldwide of installed base. So right now it's around 3,000 systems, roughly half metal and polymer systems. We have customers in 65 countries. We have in 15 countries we have own offices, and in the countries where we don't have own offices, we have distribution partners. For the rest, we are around 1,200 employees currently, 70% of them in Germany, 30% in the offices around the world. Right, and here you see some figures about the revenue. So we had 2016-17, we were around 350 million euro of revenue with all those products. Good, this is, yeah, the machine holder on there. So why additive manufacturing? Why do we need this? Why do we don't just do everything with injection molding and stuff? Additive manufacturing gives you a number of advantages that you can use that will give you that will bring you benefits in producing the parts that way compared to other ways. One example is it eliminates the constraints of conventional manufacturing. So often you can reduce the number of parts you actually need by combining a number of things into one part. So for example, this what has before this washing rotor that is in a like from Hettich in a kind of a blood centrifuge was 32 components before that were need to be assembled, and after the redesign with an additive manufactured part, it was just two laser sintered parts and a steel ring. So you have no assembly time anymore. So the part itself is not cheaper than before, but by not having the assembly, the whole life cycle cost of this application is cheaper. And also, you don't need tooling. So if you have different glasses that you have to put in there and you need different diameters, you need no tooling to produce here a different ring. You can print it directly from the cut. For this part here, if you do injection molding, you always need a mold, and mold always costs. You need to verify the mold, etc. So this is a major advantage here. And a second major advantage is you can enable a completely new design approach. So if you think about this kind of metal block where you have a like a tube goes through, and you can have a structure that from the top has a similar stability. So you can put almost the same pressure from the top on this structure, but it weighs much less. And it's, of course, on an additive manufacturing machine, much faster to produce because it's not, and you use less material, etc. So you can save for some application, especially where weight is important, like in the aerospace industry and other stuff. You can save a lot of weight that brings you an advantage over a longer period of time. So if you think about a part that is in a plane and saves a little bit of kerosene, then this will bring a lot of benefit to operating companies over the lifetime of the plane. So now we see here some applications from the aerospace. So we have here like a bracket, a holder bracket. Holder brackets are often things that are that can be optimized, because if you do this with a classical welded parts, then those things become very heavy. So it's good for redesign. And so for this type of application, you're typically 50% cheaper with a additive manufactured part. Or here, this is injector head of the engine, combustion engine of the Ariane 6. So we have developed this together with the Ariane Group. And in the Ariane 5, this component was assembled from 248 parts. And now it's printed in one part, and it's only half the price from the Ariane 5 part. So this is the type of application we're looking for. Or hydraulic components. This is a valve block from Liebherr, which is not just making these cranes and these type of stuff. Yeah. Yeah, I think that's probably titanium. Yeah, I'm not 100% sure, but probably. Yeah. So yeah, the question was, what was the material of the injector head? And I'm not completely sure, but it's possible to do these things with titanium, but I'm not sure. Often we also use Inconel, which is a nickel-based alloy, for these type of applications that are in engines. Yeah. Right, and then this is another application where Liebherr uses our systems to develop valve blocks that are in actuators of the of the climatization of the Airbus planes. So what are the challenges of industrial companies and how do we address this? So a little bit of a marketing slide. I know you're all technical people, but I think it's important to understand also the later parts about the software, why we are doing this. So basically, the industrial companies today, often they need a shorter time to market and also shorter life cycle of the product. So if you look at cars, for example, in earlier times, a car was developed maybe within 4 years and then had a lifetime of 12 years. Nowadays a car maybe is developed in 3 years, and in the future maybe it needs to be developed in 2 years, and the lifespan is not 12 years anymore, but maybe only 7 or 5 or 4 years. So the life cycle, so the parts, they are more short-lived. Cost reduction, of course, always. Flexible production, so the demand is changing a lot, so the flexibility in serving the customers, the requirements are changing. So sometimes you have a short peak of demand and then it gets lower, so it's more difficult to plan this. Then put value add into the product, customization, and also focus on sustainability. Do not throw away so much material. Like if you do traditional milling, you produce a lot of waste basically that has to be recycled. And for the additive manufacturing, we use powder, and only the powder that has been melted is in the part, and the powder that has not been melted can be reused for the next print. So we save this material. So by the advantages we provide, we pretty well serve or help out on these challenges of the industrial companies. So we have the freedom of design. We can do a lot of things that are not possible classically. We can integrate functionality. For example, the giveaway part that you had on your chairs, the moving part, so the joint, it was not assembled, it was printed in one piece, and there was some kind of distance left in between, and so you can move it, and it was printed in one part. So this is what we call, for example, functional integration. You can make a joint, and it's still printed in one piece. Customization, so you have the lot size is smaller, so you do not need maybe 10,000 of a part, but maybe you need just 800 of different styles. So because all of the customers, they want it a little bit larger, a little bit smaller, or the batch size gets smaller. So cost-effective small series. You maybe have a car that has only sells 800 per year, and then maybe it's not worth doing a part for it with injection molding if you only need 800 of it a year. Okay, so this is like a selection of the customers we had, and you see it's a pretty wide mixture of branches. So we're in the medical, we're in the automotive business, we're in the engine aerospace business. So it's from Karlsfeld to SpaceX in California, there is everything there. A lot of our customers that use the machines are service providers, because there is some of these service providers have, for example, FKM has, I think, around 35 machines from us, and they actually take in orders from also these OEMs, but others, and print parts for them. So actually, currently, they do a large part of the business. Good, so where are we today and where are we going to? So in the past, a lot was about prototyping. So someone wanted to print out a part so that he can hold something in the hand and can look it and modify it, and it just used it for prototyping, and the real part was then done with milling or with injection molding, etc. So there it was more about how fast can the part be printed and what properties did it have and how good was it then to simulate the prototyping task. Today, we're in a phase which we call pre-production. So a lot of those companies that you saw on the list, they want to qualify applications, as that means parts that they selected, for production. So they look how to get a robust process. So when they produce the part, of course, they want a repeatable quality. They want that the cost per part is in a range. In the prototyping, the cost was not so much an issue. So if this thing costs like €1,000, then never mind, because you just need it one time. But here, if you already want to go into production, then of course it's very important what will the final part in this lot size in the end cost. So this is where we're in. Some customers for applications are in here. And then already some customers have started the production ramp up with those systems for some applications. For example, MTU has already started to make the serial production of a component which goes into Aerojet engine for Airbus. And we will see this part also then in the showroom. But other companies are on the way to there. And there are totally different requirements that you have here. So suddenly you need to produce everything with a documented and same quality. You need automation. So the whole thing which the prototyper has done by hand, the whole unpacking and loading, unloading of the machine, suddenly someone wants to put robots there. So, and you need then interfaces to those robots. So you need to integrate on the mechanical side, so how to get this thing physically out with the robot, but also on the software interface side. So you need to communicate with those systems. So when is the machine ready? When can it be unloaded, etc.? You need to make software interfaces. So the requirements are changing. And we see for the solutions we are building, basically six main requirements. Some of them you already have seen: quality of parts, the productivity, quality control, documented quality of the parts, scalability, like bigger parts, but also more parts on the same platform, automation, which means material handling and part handling should be done by robots or automated and not by hand, and then integration of the systems into factories and also software integration. So that leads us to the software. Here we have an overview of what software products we have. We have four major application suites. Suites we call it because not everything is just one application, but some of those things are more than one application. So what runs on the machine we call EO system. We have a software that does job pre-calculation, so loads in the 3D parts, calculates what we need for the machine, transfers it to the machine. We call this software EOSprint. Then we have a software that does quality analysis on the sensor data of the machine, but also on specific process monitoring. We call this software EOState. And we have a connectivity element, like a gateway, and also like server-based systems, where we collect all the data and provide interfaces to allow this factory integration to other systems, to MES systems, that provides the status of the machine park to those systems. So this is basically an overview. And now what you guys are interested, where do we use C++? So that leads us basically back to the technology. So we use on the machine, for the machine control, this is basically almost everything is in C++. So for some real-time parts, we have a classical PLC, like SPS in German. But we also have a Windows-based application on the systems that is developed in C++ that does the overall logic and control. And we will have one of the talks that are following of a component that is contained here. We use C++ for the calculation algorithms in the EOSprint application, and one of the talks that will follow will talk a little bit more about what we do here. We use C++ here in the monitoring application, and we will also have more details about that, because we basically do image analysis and this type of stuff in this application, and there we're using C++. And here basically in the EOS Connect, we are almost not using C++, because this is more of a gateway, messenger, web type of application, so we are using different frameworks there. So here, besides, the other people will tell a little bit what their application use, but just to give a little bit overview of the technology stack and the tools we are using in total. So you heard in the first talk already, we are developing with Studio. And besides the C++ part, we are also using C# and WPF in these developments. We use for work item tracking, we use the Team Foundation server also for the builds. We use Git as version control system. For communication between the systems, we use OPC UA, which is an industry standard communication protocol for the factory level. So we use that. We use, for example, the ReSharper. We use in the Connect gateway, we use Kafka as a framework. We use Rapid7 as a tool to scan for vulnerabilities, so CyberSec vulnerabilities. So we scan the gateways and the systems and the operating systems with this tool. We have TestLink as a free open source test case repository. We use Ranorex and Squish from FraudLogic for test automation. So, and also we have a number of Python scripts also for the test framework, but also for other things. And we have a heavily virtualized test infrastructure. So for all the machine types, all the machine, we can basically bring everything into virtual machines that run on ESX servers so that we can test from all components, all nightly builds by an automated test. So we run in parallel around 60, 65 virtual machines that do automated testing on the systems. So this to give some technical insight. Then, of course, we do agile software development. So in 2015, we switched over to a complete, all the teams to agile software development. Our major goals basically there were to increase the customer focus. So do more of that, what really brings value, get more feedback and put feedback into the features so that the usability and the features themselves get better, be more productive by not doing things that no one needs. Better employee satisfaction, better working together, basically. So more interaction between the developers, not everybody just doing his own little thing, but as a team, work on those things and share the knowledge. And of course, shorten the release cycle. So have more releasable products than we had earlier. So what did we do? We restructured the teams into smaller teams. Basically, we use plain Scrum as a development framework. We need to do some things around it or some modifications for the system. That means the machine development projects, because they follow a classical waterfall thing, because always when Blech in German, like when metal parts are involved, then you have lead times, so they cannot just iterate every 2 weeks, because they order something and then it takes 6 months until they get it delivered. So for them, they cannot just do 2 week cycles. So we need some interactions in these projects, how to support them in an agile way, but they are still doing a waterfall. Then of course we used external consultants and also trainings for the people to introduce it. As I said, we use the Team Foundation server as a planning tool, and we bought a Surface Hub, so for the stand-ups and stuff, so we can directly not anymore use the boards, but we have the boards all virtualized, and we use this big touch screen to do the dailies and to work on the work items. What were our challenges? Just to give a little insight, what was difficult for us when doing the transition. So at the beginning, you need to establish some trust, obviously, because with the upper management, when you say, well, I want to empower the teams, et cetera, then they say, well, how can you guarantee me that they are still doing the right thing afterwards? So, I think we are in a regime now where we have this trust. Then, of course, how to sync this with classical waterfall milestones. And then you have a lot of other processes that run in the company where you have interfaces to that make problems. So like you have a project management office that asks you for your release checklist and these type of things that you don't really want to do when you want to have a releasable product every 2 weeks. So then documentation, they always ask, when is the product ready so I can take my screenshots? And then if we tell them, well, it's never ready, you have no time to take your screenshots, so we need to interact with them. How can they change their way of working so you are actually able to release those products, right? Then some number of facts. So we started in 2015. It took us approximately a year to do the complete transition. Currently, we have 9 Scrum teams with around 75 people in there. We deliver now with all products 2 customer releases per year. So this was not so frequent before that. We do marketplaces, as we show here. We do marketplaces where all the process, the product owners present the new features of the product internally, so to the service technicians, the salespeople, etc. So the knowledge about the software in the company has grown a lot by that. And we measure, of course, the velocity, and yeah, of course, yeah, it's increasing, but then of course you also have backlashes. So depending, if we do, for example, 2017 compiler transition, then sometimes things go slower, but in the end we have the increasing team velocity. So this is the generic part, and now we would dive into